So now we will be learning about the integration of metabolism. So here we will be focusing on two important hormones, insulin and glucagon. What are their metabolic effects? That is the main theme for this particular session. So this is Kishore Kondati. So objectives of this session are for this topic are: what is the structure of insulin, how it is being synthesized in the regulation part, the details of insulin receptor, and what are the metabolic effects of insulin. Then we will know how this insulin will recruit those glucose transporters, that is GLUT. Then a bit of glucagon, how it is stimulated, like inhibition and stimulation of secretion, mechanism of action. Then hypoglycemia symptoms and those insulin-induced postprandial and fasting type of hypoglycemia, and finally alcohol-related metabolism in relevance to hypoglycemia. So this is the primary structure of insulin, where you have two chains. It's a 59 amino acid peptide having two chains, A and B chains. So you can see there are some intra chain disulfide bonds and interchain disulfide bonds in insulin structure. So the second diagram, B diagram, it indicates to you that there is something called a signal sequence at the amino terminal, and then you have, this is that pre-pro insulin molecule. So when the signal sequence is taken off at the level of this endoplasmic reticulum, you have pro insulin. So insulin synthesis, it happens in this sequence of reactions, like pre-pro insulin is converted to pro-insulin, and then pro-insulin in the Golgi apparatus by the cleavage of C-peptide, it is made into actual insulin. So we will go into the details. So here you can see in this diagram, genes encoding insulin transcribed into mRNA, this is that from the gene DNA, you have mRNA being made, and this mRNA then it will be moving, it is tagging to this from a nucleus, it is coming out, and then it is going to that ribosome unit. So here you can see the N-terminal hydrophobic signal sequence that aids in the transport of mRNA to and ribosomes to RER. This is rough endoplasmic reticulum. So at this part, you have to note that N-terminal signal sequence will penetrate through the RER membrane into the RER lumen, and resulting in the formation of, this is that pre-pro insulin. This is that pre-pro insulin. So when this signal sequence is cleaved off, this violet colored spring-like structure, so then you have formation of from pre-pro-insulin to pro-insulin. So it is there in that lumen, rough endoplasmic reticular lumen. And then, so this pre-pro-insulin is then transported from RER to Golgi complex. So in the Golgi complex, where it is cleaved off that C-peptide, so this is that C-peptide. So insulin and C-peptide will be loaded into the secretory granules. So these secretory granules, they will be secreted out by exocytosis, releasing insulin and C-peptide. So there is a rationale, but that if you can quantify the C-peptide in the sample, like in the blood sample, you can know how much insulin is being made. So starting with the mRNA, and then you have this translation process from mRNA to protein. This is a peptide, and the signal sequence being cleaved to give from pre-pro to pro-insulin. Pro-insulin coming to this Golgi, again that pro-insulin getting cleaved off that C-peptide to give you actual insulin molecule. So what is the how regulation of insulin secretion happens? So this is like beta cell of islets of Langerhans of pancreas, you can see. So pre-proinsulin is converted to insulin, and then insulin moves off, and insulin can get into the blood and to the liver. It will have a lot of effects which we will be looking into. So presence of glucose and amino acid, they will stimulate this conversion of pre-proinsulin to insulin and its secretion. And epinephrine will inhibit this particular sequence of reaction. That is, synthesis of insulin is being inhibited by epinephrine. Then metabolic effects of insulin. So how do we know about that part? This is that insulin receptor which is inactive. So you have two alpha and two beta units, and beta units will be having the tyrosine kinase activity. So when insulin, this insulin molecule, when it binds to this alpha subunit, so there will be activation of this tyrosine kinase domains of the beta subunit. So these tyrosine residues of the beta subunit are autophosphorylated. So when once this tyrosine moieties or these residues are autophosphorylated, they will be acting on insulin receptor substrate. So then they will go to phosphorylation of tyrosine residues even in the insulin receptor activated substances or substrates. So they will lead to insulin receptor substrates. So these insulin receptor substrates, they will activate multiple pathways, and phosphorylation of IRS promotes activation of many kinases and phosphatases leading to biological action. So what are the biological effects of insulin? So insulin, generally it will increase the glucose uptake, it will increase glycogen synthesis, increase protein synthesis, and it will increase fat synthesis. But it will decrease gluconeogenesis, that is formation of new glucose, or derivation of glucose from glycogen, that is glycogenolysis and lipolysis. It will inhibit lipolysis. So so whenever there is a altered gene expression, all these up arrows or down arrows, they will be jumbled and to make the disease diabetes. So here in this diagram, what we are trying to know is that how these GLUT molecules, GLUT are glucose transporter molecules, how they are being initiated, like how they perform, how they come to the membrane and help in the movement of glucose. So first we will start with this part. When insulin binds to the receptor, as we have seen, this is that insulin receptor having alpha and beta subunits. So when it binds to this part, so what's happening? Like you will have activated receptor promoting the recruitment. So this one is recruiting the glucose transporters from intracellular pool to membrane. So these are moving to the cell membrane. So when they fuse and they make these glucose transporters, they will increase the insulin mediated glucose uptake. These molecules, pink molecules, are those glucose molecules which are taken in. After some time, when insulin levels will decrease, so these glucose transporters, again they will get internalized and they will be forming by fission, and again they will be getting fused with the vesicles to form endosomes, and they will be staying back in the cell. So when the need arises or arrives that glucose has to be taken into the cell, these GLUT molecules, that is when insulin binds to the receptor, GLUT molecules are being recruited to move to the membrane by fusion. They make these transporter molecules at the membrane, move the glucose into the cell, and then again they get internalized and make an endosome. So this insulin and glucagon, both they act in opposite way, that is they are antagonistic hormones. So you can see insulin, it will decrease glycogenolysis, it will decrease gluconeogenesis, ketogenesis or lipolysis, whereas glucagon, you can say it is increasing glycogenolysis, exact opposite pedal, gluconeogenesis, ketogenesis and lipolysis. So in short, insulin is hypoglycemic, whereas glucagon is hyperglycemic hormone. So how this secretion of glucagon is being helped? Like, so this is that alpha cell of pancreas, where from precursors you will have glucagon being formed. This glucagon moves out and then it will act and route this blood to liver. So presence of epinephrine and amino acids will stimulate glucagon formation. or secretion. But glucose will inhibit the secretion of glucagon. So now a bit into details at the level of glucagon hormone binding to this receptor, then activating this adenylyl cyclase. So this adenylyl cyclase, it catalyzes the conversion of ATP to cyclic AMP. Cyclic AMP will be activating, like cyclic AMP dependent protein kinases which are inactive will be made into active form, and these regulatory subunits will be bound by those cyclic AMP molecules, and then the catalytic units, they will catalyze the phosphorylation reactions. Like some of the enzymes are dephosphorylated, so they will be made into phosphorylated enzymes. So when this enzymes dephosphorylation phosphorylation reaction happens, so you can see there are the biological effects of this glucagon come into act, like increased glycogenolysis, increased gluconeogenesis, increased lipolysis, increased ketogenesis, increased uptake of amino acids, but decrease glycogenesis. So as you have kinases giving that phosphate to enzyme, tagging that phosphate to enzyme, you have even protein phosphatases which will be removing that phosphate, which we have already learned in the carbohydrate metabolism. And what is this hypoglycemia? So hypoglycemia is said the blood glucose is less than 40 milligrams per deciliter. So immediately there will be stimulation of the hypothalamic regulatory center and pituitary. It will secrete ACTH, that is adrenocorticotropic hormone, and hypothalamic regulatory center will act on autonomous nervous system, and this will act on norepinephrine, and from adrenal cortex you will have epinephrine being stimulated, and here you have cortisol being made. A nervous system, it will act on pancreas. It will stop the secretion of insulin, but glucagon secretion is increased. So whenever there is a low blood glucose, so these cortisol, epinephrine, norepinephrine, glucagon will act, and insulin will be stopped. So what these molecules are doing? These molecules, they are causing stimulation, particularly these norepinephrine, epinephrine. They will cause the lysis of glycogen, that is glycogenolysis, to give the glucose from glycogen, and then gluconeogenesis is stimulated by cortisol as well as glucagon. So glucagon, in part, it will act both way, that is glycogenolysis and gluconeogenesis are being stimulated by glucagon. And this is just like a time scale or a glucose concentration, a blood glucose concentration scale. So what are the events that happen? Suppose at around 70 you will have insulin production being stopped or decreased. Suppose it is around say 70 milligrams per deciliter, so epinephrine and glucagon production increases, growth hormone production increases, cortisol production increases when it is less than 60, and all these adrenergic symptoms like anxiety, palpitation, tremor and sweating, they come into act if it is getting below 250. And below 50 you can see this neuroglycopenia symptoms, begin headache, confusion, slurred speech, seizures, coma and death. Neuroglycopenia is a term that is given when brain is deprived of its very essential fuel, that is glucose. You call that term as neuroglycopenia. So this is just to show you that how they have made out, like what happens with insulin and what happens when glucagon is given and how saline is being given. Like, so glucose levels have been tested with, like, first a patient with type 1 diabetes were injected with insulin. You can see the blood glucose level is being somewhere here, and some patients were treated with saline instead of glucagon. So you can see here, and like after several hours, some patients were also treated with subcutaneous glucagon. So here you can see that after glucagon, like glucagon increases blood glucose by mobilizing liver glycogen and also gluconeogenesis, which we have learnt in that table. So blood glucose value will be raised here. Do remember, glucagon acts on two particular pathways, glycogenolysis and gluconeogenesis. And then we have come to this comparison between ethanol metabolism and non-ethanol, like a person consuming ethanol, how the carbohydrate metabolism changes in relevance to ethanol metabolism. So first one is, without ethanol, generally glucose 6-phosphate, and then phosphoenyl pyruvate to pyruvate oxalate state, and all these gluconeogenic precursors are there. So important point, metabolism of ethanol results in massive increase in the concentration of cytosolic NADH. So this is that molecule. So ethanol alcohol dehydrogenase will generate lot of NADH. So when ethanol increases this NADH, it causes the intermediates of gluconeogenesis to be diverted to alternate reactions. So when there is increase in this NADH, there will be diversion to alternate pathways. So that reduces the synthesis of glucose. So you can see from this, so all these gluconeogenic precursors, suppose oxalate and this pyruvate, will be moved to lactate. From oxalate again, malate will be coming. And here you can see some of the people who are really into that alcoholism, they can be helped by giving this disulfiram, which will inhibit this reaction of conversion of acetaldehyde to acetate, and this aldehyde rehydrogenase enzyme is being inhibited. So this helps in alcoholic people in part reducing this amount of NADH being raised. So with this we have come to the end of this session, wherein we have learned the insulin structure, how insulin receptors are being, what is the feature, what are the features of the insulin receptor, then how glucose and transporters are being internalized and they come to the membrane and to perform their functions, and then some of the effects of insulin, and how the things about tyrosine kinase activity of insulin receptor, and then glucagon and what is its structure, and then how it functions, how it activates that cyclic AMP dependent protein kinase, and then we have learned about hypoglycemia and hypoglycemia, what are the causes, and then ethanol metabolism in relation to glucose metabolism.